Best of all, she was quite untarnished either by the sordid political world Rudolph was forced to inhabit or by the tedious social round that had, until now, been his only alternative. Susceptible, as he was at the time, the disillusioned, world-weary Rudolph fell madly in love and was soon planning to divorce his sour-tempered wife and marry Maria. Rudolph was well aware that he and Maria were being followed by palace agents. Whenever they met, and although he realized that this meant the liaison would soon reach the emperor's ears, he had become reckless enough not to care. All he cared about was Maria and the fact that he could not live without her. Rudolph and Maria Vetsero became lovers on the 13th of January, 1889, and the prince was so wrapped up in this, his first serious affair, that he gave Maria a ring inscribed with the date to commemorate the event. A sharp jolt back to reality was soon forthcoming. By the 26th of January, the emperor had his possession a letter from Pope Leo XIII, which revealed that Rudolph had written directly to the pontiff, asking him to permit the dissolution of his marriage to Stephanie. Such a direct contact was a breach of protocol, and told Franz Joseph that a liaison with Maria that had prompted the request was going to be a serious problem. A divorce from Stephanie was out of the question, no matter how unhappy the marriage was. The stability of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, which relied on the united royal family, would not permit it. It was then that Rudolph realized just how much he was in his father's power and how little courage he possessed to resist him. Franz Joseph summoned his son to appear before him and demanded a promise that Rudolph would send Maria away. Thoroughly dejected, the crown prince complied, asking only that he might see her just once more. Having got what he wanted, the emperor agreed, little realizing how shamed and hopeless his son felt as he left his presence. 2 days later, the crown prince Rudolph left Vienna for Mayerling, ostensibly for some midwinter hunting in the surrounding forests. Maria Vetsera was with him. On the afternoon of the 29th of January, the two of them took a long walk in the forest, and there, it seems, Rudolph proposed a suicide pact. To him, it was the only way out of what he saw as his meaningless life. The besotted Maria agreed. Most likely, she had no realistic concept of death, and doubtless thought only of herself and Rudolph mysteriously united in perpetuity beyond the grave. That night, both of them wrote letters to their mothers. Rudolph asked Empress Elizabeth to see that he and Maria were buried together in a small nearby cemetery at Åland. The request was never granted. That done, Rudolph bolted the door of the bedroom from the inside. Sometime around dawn, when Maria was asleep, he fetched his revolver from a drawer and shot her behind the left ear. The range was point blank, and she died instantly. Rudolph's manservant, Lotch, heard the noise. He leapt out of bed and rushed along the hallway to his master's room. The second shot rang out as he arrived, too late, outside the door. Vatican cover-up. In the 19th century, suicide was regarded as a sin in the eyes of the Catholic Church. Consequently, a big cover-up attempted to conceal the circumstances of Rudolph's death. Heart failure was the first official explanation. Then a story was disseminated that he had been killed by conservative elements fearful of his liberal influence. Next, the Vatican issued a statement that Rudolph had been mentally unbalanced when he died. No one was really convinced, and eventually, the truth had to be admitted. Crown Prince Rudolph and Maria Vetsever had died in a suicide pact. This, though, was not allowed to the end of the story. Conspiracy theories had always sprung up and were proliferating even before the truth about the deaths of Rudolph and Maria was reluctantly announced. Conspiracy theories never died, and no official announcement, whether a cover-up or truth, had the slightest effect on any of the many explanations surrounding the hunting lodge at Mayerling and the tragic events that happened there. Emperor Maximilian of Mexico. The Archduke Maximilian, younger brother of Emperor Franz Joseph of Austria-Hungary, 1832 to 1867, was the quote-unquote fall guy in a scheme hatched in 1863 by the French Emperor Napoleon III. The idea was for Maximilian to retrieve money owed to France by the Mexican government. Napoleon's allies in Mexico, the Catholic Church, and the group of wealthy landowners had also been disposed of their land, cash, and privileges by the liberal president of Mexico, Benito Juarez. They, too, wanted their money back. With this reluctant assent of Franz Joseph, the landowners offered Maximilian the Mexican throne. He accepted. So far, so good. But there was a problem. Maximilian was a naive, starry-eyed idealist with a head full of utopian notions about the banishing the poverty, squalor, and disease that disfigured life for millions of disadvantaged people in Mexico and around the world. Maximilian arrived in the empire in 1864, accompanied by a substantial force of French troops and his wife Charlotte, daughter of the Belgian King Leopold I. Charlotte, too, had her heads in the cloud. To her, Maximilian was an angel whose destiny was to serve and uplift humanity. But for his sponsors, Napoleon III and Franz Joseph, Maximilian was a high-minded wimp who caused trouble from the start. He refused to stir to restore church property and privileges on the grounds that the church belonged to the people. For the same reasons, Maximilian declined to let landowners take back their lost estates and hiatuses. Next, Maximilian proceeded with utopian schemes such as a national theater for Mexico and their creation of a world navy. He took to walking through the streets of Mexico City with minimal escort, engaging in friendly conversation with passerbys. He was so obviously genuine that even Benito Juarez and his supporters found it hard to dislike him. This did not mean that Juarez approved of Maximilian's assumption of power. Typically, on learning of Juarez's hostility, Maximilian invited him to Mexico City, thinking to offer the Mexican leader a place to his government. Juarez, of course, refused. Mayhem followed. Motley groups of bandits, some of them Juarez partisans, made the night and the roads dangerous. Juarez and his forces were still at large, awaiting for their chance to fight and defeat the foreign intruders. The Americans then stepped in with demands that the French leave Mexico and take Maximilian with them. Maximilian refused at first, but as American pressure increased, he began to waver. Charlotte refused to hear of giving up and sailed to Europe to seek help. She arrived in August 1866, but soon discovered that nobody wanted to know. Napoleon III was facing fresh pressure from a rampant Germany on France's eastern frontier and needed his troops home. He was willing to abandon Maximilian in order to do so. Never very stable, Charlotte's mind gave away as fear, failure, and stress finally snapped her sanity. When Maximilian learned of her condition, his first thought was to be with her. His second was to remain in Mexico, where he believed deserting his subjects would be cowardly and dishonorable. The same applied to the abdication, which his brother urged on him. By January 1867, French troops had withdrawn from Mexico, and the armies of Benito Juarez were sweeping towards Mexico City. Maximilian still refused to cut and run. The most he would do was leave for Querétaro, northwest of Mexico City. He was still there when the Juarez forces arrived and captured him. Loath to execute him because he was so disconcertingly noble. The Mexicans tried persuading him to escape. Yet again, Maximilian refused. He seemed intent on martyrdom as the only honorable way out. All the Mexicans could do was to oblige. And on June 19, 1867, Maximilian was marched out of Querétaro to the nearby Hill of Bells. A firing squad awaited him. Taking a deep breath of the ice fresh mountain air, Maximilian declared, "What a glorious day. I have always wanted to die on such a day." Seconds later, he was dead. The news took 10 days to reach Europe. 9 months passed before her family dared tell Charlotte what had happened. She survived her husband by 40 years, which she spent mumbling to herself and gazing at pictures of Maximilian, or smashing anything breakable and ripping up carpets, curtains, and upholsteries in violent fury. She died, still hopelessly insane, in 1927. I'm not quite sure why this is added into here, but it is added into the Mayerling tragedy, and I think it's just to prove, actually, that there was insanity in this family. So yet again, kings and queens took far longer than I thought it would. After we talk about these events, I think it's important that we do our own research and get both sides to everything and see what everybody's saying on all sides. So, yet again, I hope you learned a lot, and I will see you all again soon.